Hey there, Cheryl here. Today is a special day. I'm so excited to be here with you, Gwen Murphy of Athena Analytics LLC. We are talking about a very, very important topic today. Welcome.
Yeah, thanks for having me. I love what you're show, so appreciate it.
Yeah, and so I'm really excited because a lot of us, we don't, I think a lot of people, well, maybe people in technology know a lot about AI, and maybe for the layperson, we have a general understanding, but there's some really important issues coming up as AI becomes more and more and more prevalent in our lives, and that's the issue of ethics in AI. And before we get into talking about that, I was just wondering if you could shed a little light on when you were young. I mean, you're still a young person, but when you were a younger person, maybe growing up, is there something that really inspired you to technology and more specifically inspired you to really get lit up about this subject matter?
Actually, yeah, it's funny you ask that because, I mean, I feel like I've been destined to exactly this role since I was a child. I mean, I grew up in a very, very religious community, and I think that there was a bit of a dichotomy of things going on as my, in my head as a kid. I was pretty cerebral. I kind of saw these messages, and I remember getting a blessing from my priest, and he the blessings, they kind of record them, and you're supposed to read them later, and it talked a lot about how I would, if I lived a good life, I'd get married and have children. And I remember getting it in the mail later because they type it up later and you're kind of nervous when you're hearing it, but I got it in the mail later and I read it to my mom and I said, this can't be right. Like, there must be more, and I so there, that was kind of like mixed with the fact that I wasn't crazy about like Star Trek and the $6 Million Man. And you remember the Bionic Woman? I'm totally dating myself now.
No, I
But
love that show, so I'll date myself with you. Yeah.
right. So I totally love the Bionic Woman. And as a kid, I used to play in the street and pretend I was the Bionic Woman. I could beat up the neighbor boys and jump over tall fences. And so that whole idea of robots and cyborgs. And then it's so just totally coincidental. I had left home to go to college and went for my master's degree and started studying nanotechnology and a technology called atomic computing, which was my thesis was on nanotechnology and theories of replication. And replication is now kind of what you see in digital computing. Like you can recreate a gun or you can create something from atoms. And so that technology back then, when I did my master's, there was this whole futuristic idea. Wired magazine was writing about it, that one day humans would become more augmented over time. And it's just so funny that that was just such a, my favorite show when I was a kid, and here we are, right? Working with robotics and artificial intelligence. It's kind of fun.
Yeah, so that is really amazing. And it goes along with really my firm belief that all of us have something really special placed within us. And it sounds like what was really special for you and very purpose driven was kind of not just placed in you. I think it's kind of placed in everyone at a young age, but you really realized it in a young age. And you know what a blessing that is, because a lot of times people spend a lifetime trying to figure that out. So moving ahead then, for when it comes to AI, what is of special interest about AI and ethics? Because it seems like a lot of technology, it can be really used for the greater good, but also it can be used for maybe some not so good. So what is the focus of Athena Advisory, and what makes you so enthusiastic about the ethics part of it?
Yeah, that's a great question. So I kind of have to break that up into two pieces. Like first, I'll talk about what is Athena Advisory, because it's ethics, but it's also more. And then I'll talk about how we came to the ethics, because it's kind of got a little bit longer story. So hopefully you want to hear, but interrupt me if I carry on too long. But the Athena Advisory is focused on what we love to do. And we've done this in prior roles in Big Four firms. I worked for IBM for several years, really doing emerging technology strategy, data strategy, enterprise architecture type techniques, techniques where you clean up data environments. So this is just kind of a transition. Every time a new technology came along, a technology strategist picks it up and moves to the next thing. But Athena, we said we want to focus on what's called data, you know, data strategy, data innovation, and monetization. And just to give you kind of a simple story, I mean, today, artificial intelligence is going into everything from Callaway golf clubs where there's AI in it and they're tracking your swing, and the Callaway home office is studying how everybody swings so they can improve their clubs, to if you ride a bicycle, you can put a IoT device, Internet of Things device on it, which is just a device that captures new data, data on how often maybe a professional biker shifts his gear when he goes up a hill or down a hill. You marry that data to GPS data, you start to create new products and services. And that's really the story of Athena, the goddess Athena. That was what she did. She was the goddess of insights, knowledge. She helped throughout Greece create new products and services and crafts. And so it was just such a perfect name to attach to what our mission was. But it's not just creating products and services for corporations. When you look at the way these technologies and artificial intelligence and machine learning can be applied to our society, we could create a beautiful world. I mean, there's a book called Enchanted Objects by, I think it's David Rose, if people are interested. He predicts a future where everything from, you know, your medicine box, you know, your pill box from the pharmacy would have a device in it to remind you if you took your medicine that day, to your umbrella, you know, when you walk out the door saying, you better take me with you, you know, like really an enchanted world. And so that's what I just love about it. I've always been a gadget girl and love that. So going into clients and helping them ideate, how do they want to create products and services, or working with NGOs or the United Nations or groups that are doing sustainable development and finding ways to leverage that technology in farming communities and other places is really a passion of ours. But on the ethics side, the whole story behind ethics goes back to my co-founder and I, Robert Taub, and I worked at Ernst & Young. And I was asked to speak at it's a W20 event. Probably everybody listening's heard of the G20 events where the presidents get together, I think every quarter or something, and they talk about, you know, what's going on in their countries, the state of affairs for women, for children, for poor people, you know, all these different topics. And I went to this conference and spoke on how do we close the digital divide and get more women in technology. And it was during that presentation, or after that presentation, the former Prime Minister of New Zealand, you know, came up to me and said, you know, Gwen, could Ernst & Young do a study of robotics, blockchain, and artificial intelligence on the lives of women and girls, and look at it from different aspects, like poverty, food security, the future of work, how much is this gonna affect women's lives as far as work goes? So I went back and asked my team, and I had the best team, and I said, hey, you wanna volunteer to do this piece of work? And Robert Taub and I picked up this piece of work. We got people from all over the world to join in. We got people from the Ernst & Young Innovation Center and the tech sector in California to all brainstorm. And it was really fascinating because tech people like me, we're all gung-ho. You know, I mean, I expect that I'm going to be a robot one day. You know, it's okay. Okay, I'll do that. I'll give that a shot. But policy people are like, oh my God, what are we doing? So let's think about this before we do it. And when you put them together, it's like, our eyes just opened up because some of the things that are coming, and I don't want to totally shock the crowd, but you can go to my LinkedIn. One of my colleagues posted something and I just posted it as well on, can we create humans? And it was during that study that we kind of opened our eyes that blockchain is being used for human trafficking and all sorts of negative things. But at the same time, it's being used to make sure in the supply chains, there's no child labor, you know, the laws that are broken. You know, we're not enslaving people to work to create products for our American brands, you know, or things like that, that we discovered that there's such a thing as a robot brothel where, you know, this is a new thing. I know whenever I tell anybody that, their chins drop. But now this is the thing. They're all over Asia. There's a couple in Canada. They just opened one, or they're opening one in Houston, Texas. There's all sorts of emerging technology that it's not just artificial intelligence. There's all these other emerging technologies that to me are really, really concerning. And So we did, we produced that study. We produced a bunch of tear sheets and, you know, things that we could give to business people, to ambassadors, and to, you know, policymakers, so that they, we could educate them early on, you know, let's start getting out ahead of this. And we produced what was really, I think, one of the first artificial intelligence frameworks, which is just a way of thinking about, you know, creating the AI for human purposes and ethical purposes. And then the work just kind of sat around for a couple of years. And it was, you know, when the pandemic hit, I think everybody's lives changed, or a lot of people's lives changed. And we said, oh my gosh, what are we doing? And I launched back in June, Athena. And that's kind of the history of how, you know, we got into this. And we said, oh my God, our skills as system designers, you know, we know both system design and governance. If you're doing innovation in the innovation process, when you're thinking about creating new products and services, nowadays it's not just creating a product and service and saying, how much is it contributing to GDP? How much is it contributing to my ROI? If I'm creating a robot or artificial intelligence, how much is it improving the society? And how much is it improving human well-being? Or are we, you know, and are we creating robots that are going to negatively impact or replace people's jobs or have a negative impact of our lives? And how are we caring for that over time? But it's not just that. I mean, our methodology actually helps clients embed throughout their processes, instantiate governance and other activities where, you know, there's checkpoints to consider things. It's, you know, in sort of, I'll just give you one more example. If my light just went out. If in regular system design, when you design a system or a website, it has a limitation. You interact with it a certain way. There's only so many buttons to press, and it does certain things. When you deploy an artificial intelligence or machine learning system that's learning and changing, the operators that monitor that need to keep an eye on it, because to your point, it's using data. And to the extent that that data is biased or not biased or is using historical information, that could be a very bad thing over time. So it's after those kinds of systems are deployed and the data that they're using, where all sorts of other concerns, policy concerns, you know, come into play. So that's kind of how we got here. And we're just having a ton of fun with it.
Yeah, so it seems like such important work. And if I can make the comparison to the DE&I space, which is kind of on the forefront of everybody's mind too, is that there's, you know, one article I read recently is that, and I'll tell you what this has to do with what you were just talking about, but, you know, 80%+ of the people want to do good in the DE&I space, but a lot of times they don't understand they're being biased, they don't understand their privilege, they don't understand, there's a lot of things that they just don't understand. It's good people that are not educated, opposed to the really awful people who are intentionally out doing awful things. And it seems like it might be the same thing with AI, with these companies that set out and they have good intentions, but maybe they're not educated or not aware and they don't understand the cumulative effect of what they're doing. And kind of like, it's similar to in coaching, when I'm working with someone, I help on that. This is a very, very small one-on-one or group cohort level, but we help course correct. I mean, that's just the perspective. And it seems like on a much broader scale, when it comes to AI and ethics and a lot of the other things that Athena Advisory is doing, that you can help that course correction of mostly good companies trying to use it in a right way. And then also course correcting very rapidly the other percentage of ways that AI has been using maybe to everyone's detriment.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a real concern. It's interesting. I was on a call because we engage a lot with policy institutes, with the IEEE, which is the Institute for Electrical and Electrical Engineers. They establish all sorts of standards, all sorts of different groups. And I was on a call with a group in the UK called the AI Policy Network. And the girl gave me a terrific example that I just loved. I mean, when cars came around, you know, people were driving, all sorts of accidents happened. You know, people just ran, you know, went whatever speed they wanted. And after a while, people said, maybe we shouldn't do this like this. Maybe we need these little red stop signs. Maybe we need lights. Maybe we need lanes so that you stay on your side of the road. And unfortunately, with artificial intelligence, I mean, we've got situations where brands are, you know, brands, you know, I'm not going to say a particular brand name, but, you know, very popular brands are on Facebook. And next thing they know is that their brand is sitting next to a conspiracy theory content or neo-Nazi content. And that's not where people want their brands. That's not what they pay, why they pay to be on Facebook. You know, that the brands are running into these problems with algorithms, and Facebook, you know, is now kind of learning. And like I said, you know, just like the invention of cars, you know, policies are going to come. I'm hearing from policy institutes that they really want to, you know, there's been some discussion about, you know, going after and prosecuting designers of these algorithms. And now they're saying operators who release them into our environment. And I'm sure you've heard stories about like cars that auto driving cars that had accidents and a woman died. This is now a lawsuit. You know, these are sad stories, but this is what happens when the world moves forward and we invent new technologies. But at the same time, you know, our government is really behind on this topic, and I think they recognize it now. There's been a new, some new folks put in charge of the technology and science committees in Washington, and we're hoping that folks will get out in front of it a little bit, but not stifle innovation. It's, I think that it's one of the most important areas right now for our country to stay competitive. I don't think we should stop a lot of the innovation. I mean, and I always use the analogy that I know a lot of folks you hear, you know, people are creating these weapons and autonomous drones that, you know, kill people through facial recognition. But these are really important technologies, and we're safe and in the situation where we are today because of nuclear weapons. And while nuclear weapons, you know, have, you know, killed people, it's been a terribly sad history. You know, Marie Curie invented the technology that brought us radium and polonium. She's the only, by the way, she's a woman, since this is a women's leadership group, she's the only male or female to have Nobel Prizes in two areas of science. So that should encourage women to go into STEM. But that technology and having nuclear weapons is what really keeps the world safe. And we keep the world safe through those treaties, right? So what we need is to continue to create weapons. We need to be powerful, a powerful country. Our fighting forces need to be the best in the world, but we need to have treaties and conversations about how to actually use them. But I think what's most important to me is how all this got started with my co-founder, Robert Taub, and I, is how this has been impacting the lives of women and girls. It's pretty extraordinary. And there's going to be more women losing their jobs as a result of artificial intelligence than men by significant numbers. So retraining and those things are really important.
Yeah, I wanted to segue into that because I know that you have a special place in your heart to support women and girls and to, you know, empower them to be their best. So we have that in common. And can you just shine, like take a minute or two to shine some light on how your work at Athena Advisory helps with that?
Well, I mean, you know, if we don't get some ethics into corporations and we don't get corporations to bring us in and help them when they develop new products and services, ideate, not just economic drivers, like I'd mentioned earlier, but also talk about human well-being. You know, is this going to have humanitarian issues? Is it aligned to human rights? You know, we have a whole methodology for doing this. If we don't do that, then think about the alternative, you know? So, and I, you know, I'll tell you a little story. United Nations did a study on, you know, Alexa and Cortana and Siri and all these devices that were coming out. And the second I got my device, I have a British male on my phone, the voice, right? Because immediately I was like, what's that? And I went looking and I found a British voice, you know, on the Siri. In fact, I don't want to say it too loud because he'll start speaking. But they did a study comparing, you know, Alexa and all these other devices. And when they were programmed, they named the report, "I Think I Could Blush," because if you said certain things to Cortana or Siri or Alexa, negative things, like if you said, "Alexa, you're a bitch," her response was, "Oh, I think I could blush," right? So they had this whole like table on things that they said to these all these different devices. And then they looked at the features and functionality and said, well, can you make it a male voice? And why did you name it a female? I mean, we've had everything from Alexa and Siri to salad making machines named Sally. And you have to ask yourself every time you log on, does a bot have to be a woman? I logged on to my credit union the other day and my bot's name is Brittany and she's here to help. After a while, it's like we're reinforcing stereotypes. So, you know, all what the UN study that they did, and again, its title, I think I could blush, you could probably Google it, but they went back to Amazon and Microsoft and all these companies, and they started changing. And the only way to drive change is to have more women involved in the design, have more, you know, women involved in programming, because, you know, clearly, you know, men are the only ones doing coding. If they have to code it to respond to something, they're going to code what they think it should say. So
it's similar to when, you know, there's just a big, you know, a raised awareness that there's, you know, we need more female leaders, you know, especially in technology. And so there's awareness about it, but is there a big push and are the big things happening? And, you know, Resource just did an amazing DE&I panel, how a lot of times you need to have, this is similar in my perspective to the importance of AI, you have to have people that look like the people that you're trying to bring in. It's the same thing, you know, with bots. What are young girls and women going to be perceived at, just as in kind of the service industry rather than the leadership industry? So I definitely think that is important and really vital, because women have a different level, a different type of conscious capitalism, a different lens that they're looking through, a different sense of integrity and type of nurturing and all these different things, that it's not one better than the other. But gosh, it's not only unfortunate if women aren't heard, especially in technology that's rapidly changing the world, it's almost dangerous, sounds like.
If I know, exactly. I mean, you know, I don't want to get too, you know, crazy or make people too nervous, but there's other technology emerging. I mean, we've got robot brothels, you know, robots being dolls. And you can look at my LinkedIn. I just published there's a movie about this topic. It's on my... You've got, you know, algorithms and all these things coming out with female names and, you know, kind of reinforcing stereotypes. But there's other technology, you know, like artificial wombs, right? The technology first came along with one of the most beautiful purposes, because so many women lose their children, they can't carry them to term. So all these babies are born premature and they don't survive. So this technology called artificial wombs, and you can Google it, now is kind of shifting over into vanity projects and all sorts of things about abortion rights and all sorts of things are kind of spewing in to talk about it. But if you ask yourself, you know, when you look at everything in its totality, why is so much of this technology affecting the lives of women and girls? So I do think that we need to really get our head around this. I think women need to step up and say, you know, this is not the way we want the future to be. There's one study said that by 2015, men and women will have more relationship or more intimate interactions with robots and machines than they will each other. You know, maybe that's the future and maybe that's the way it's, you know, going to be. And maybe we will evolve slowly to get used to it. But, you know, we can make a decision to deliberately design these services and these solutions with the kind of world that we envision, and not accept things as they are and just recreate things as they are or the way that we wouldn't want them to be. You know, there's always going to be a little bit of that, but I think if we can get companies to do more and invest more in the good and having good conversations about making sure that you're not just making money, that this isn't reinforcing some negative stereotype about some group, you know, I think it'll go a long way. But right now what we're seeing is, you know, the other side's outpacing in many ways. So we have work to do.
Yeah, and I think that your knowledge combined, like you said, with policy is going to be very powerful. And, you know, before we get into how people can contact you or learn more, I want to ask you, of course, because being the mental toughness and high performance coach, I have to ask you this question. And that is going from a young girl to working for like the, you know, one or two or three of the big four, and going from creating this amazing company that can really help transform the world or course correct the world back kind of on track to where it needs to be in this regard. What mindset has allowed you to get to this point, and do you think gives you optimism about the future?
Well, I think that the mindset, or the thing that, you know, kind of I always think about, and, you know, I think people who know me and hear me say this, or who have been on my teams, I've always said, hone your craft, right? Know your stuff. There's a wonderful book by, I think, Sylvia Ann Hewitt is the name, called Executive Presence. And she did real data-driven research that showed that, you know, it doesn't matter how you look, doesn't matter, you know, those things, you know, certain things about how you speak, you know, the school you went to, you know, the things that really matter is your ability to establish credibility. And that means, and what doesn't matter if it's men or women, if you have honed your craft and you know your stuff, it really brings a lot of mental kind of confidence to what you do. And I think like, and I think like I got there because I kind of realized early on, in fact, I was working at IBM and I was always working with a lot of architects, and the best architects were from Germany and India. I'm sorry, Germany and Ireland and the UK. And I said to myself one day, my God, why are these people so well-trained? And I got myself a German mentor and I said, what's going on over there? And they said, well, you know, we don't focus on mentors and sponsors. We focus on apprenticeships. And it was at that time that I said, oh my gosh, how do I get into some apprenticeships? So I've had mentees who say to me, you know, oh, I've had the same mentor for 10 years. I've reviewed my roadmap. I'm not really moving forward. And I say, well, fire your mentor, you know, get some apprenticeships, right? Because if your career isn't moving, your mentors and sponsors can do so much, but through apprenticeships, you hone your craft. And that when you really have to stand up and do something and have confidence in, you know, those last minute moments and have credibility, that's what's really going to matter. But her book on executive presence is fabulous. And she really talks about the things that matter and the way we dress at work and all these things. You know, I think a lot of folks think that those things don't matter. They do, you know, and it's interesting, but she's got a real data-driven book on it.
Yeah. So that's fascinating. I know we walk, you know, you probably heard the study that it's the words that we say carry about 7% of how we're perceived. And then it's really has to do with our tone and gestures. And so I love what you're saying. I want to, and I've coined the term hone it and own it. I know this is going on a water bottle. We have swag, not this yet, but we'll send some Limitless Leader swag your way. And who knows, you might get a hone it and own it water bottle. I really want to make sure I've been blessed to work with so many high level leaders and here in San Francisco, Silicon Valley, and one thing that they're not doing is verbal. They're not, especially women who are further marginalized. They're the only, they're not verbalizing. Mm-hmm. They're owning it and they're confident in what they're doing, but they're not owning it. They're not speaking up. They're not being heard, and it's doing themselves an injustice and those around them. So for all those amazing women out there that are listening in, I want you to listen to Gwen and hopefully listen to me and just speak up and let others know about all the amazing things that you're doing. Yeah. Now, Gwen, I really want to honor all of your efforts and your passion and this really big job that you're taking on, because it is a big job, but you jumped in with 2 feet. And I want to let people know that if you are interested in ethics, artificial intelligence and ethics, there is a link scrolling down below. If you want to learn more about all of the incredible things that the Athena Advisory is doing, you can go to athenaadvisory.tech. And again, if you want the information on AI and ethics, that's scrolling down below. It's just /AI-ethics. Mm-hmm. Gwen Murphy, keep up all of your incredible work. I am cheering you on from San Francisco. And
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, and I look forward to continuing to follow you.
Yeah, thank you. I look forward to talking to you again. Thanks for having me.